Beautiful. Thank you. Good morning. Welcome. It's great to have folks here this morning. It's such a delight to see you. And welcome for those folks online. As I've said before now, we used to say, you know, turn off your cell phones in church. Now we just tell you to turn them down. So you're welcome to engage. You can like, you can check in, you can do the emoji thing. My emojis are expanding. And you can also put in a prayer request and welcome people, what have you. And so it's just a new world. So we're getting used to that. And I think we're doing pretty well with it. We're not arrived yet or anything, but it's great to have you with us, whether you're at home or here in our house. Couple announcements this morning. First of all, September 13th, we're having Rally Sunday under special circumstances. So these are unusual times, but we will be out in the pavilion, and that is the safest place to be. Now, we will be broadcasting live, okay? So I want folks to know they can tune in on Facebook as usual. If you're here, we'll be spread out. We will be socially distancing and wearing masks, even as folks are here in worship this morning, and I am when I'm not up here. But we'll be wearing masks, and we'll have masks if you don't have them. We are going to have a picnic afterwards. Oh, it's a single service Sunday, so that's at 10:45. But before that, 9:30, there'll be special games and crafts for our kids. Not sure yet if we'll be having adult Sunday school or not. We have one with Zoom now anyway, but we're working on that. But there'll at least be a social hour for adults, socially distanced. But we'll have some great games for kids that Terry and company have been putting together. And then following the worship service, we will have a picnic. Now, with in mind that we are in a pandemic, this is what we're going to do. So we're going to have all the meat that is on the grill there. We're going to have servers with gloves on. They're going to put it into a styrofoam tray along with prepackaged chips and prepackaged cookies. And then that will be given to you. So you can stay and eat at the tables there. Or you can bring a blanket and spread it out on the field, or you can take those dishes home. We do realize, as we're thinking about this, that even though we're wearing masks during the service, that you have to take off your mask to eat, unless you've come up with some technique that we are not aware of yet. So if you have, let us know. But in any case, that's the way we're going to do the picnic. So and then we are going to probably have a model rocket launch, and then I'm going to try to do a drone video of us at the end. Why not? I mean, just try to do something new in the midst of all this, right? So enjoy that. I do want to say that amidst the pandemic, there's some wonderful blessings of joy. And this week, we had three babies born into the church. And so we are delighted and excited about that. So we had Maggie J and Matt had little Chet Allen born. We're excited for them. And then Danny and Jack Timmons had little Veronica Lou born. And I missed this one at the first service. I'm so sorry about it. But late last night at 11 o'clock p.m., because I checked my social media at midnight and it hadn't happened yet. But at 11 o'clock, Rachel and Justin Ott had Kenneth Theodore. And so let's go ahead and just celebrate that wherever you are. We're so excited. Didn't they say something about a pandemic baby boom? Well, we've got it. So we're excited about that. And now we turn our thoughts and minds to worship. And we are using Psalm 40, one of my favorite psalms. I waited patiently for the Lord. He lifted me out of the slimy pit. He set my feet on a rock. He put a new song in my mouth. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. God is good all the time. Praise the Lord. We invite you to stand and join in worship and music.
Good morning. So today I want to talk some more about going back to school. Last week we talked about going back to school with the fruits of the Spirit. And so some of you like to go back to school shopping for clothes. But the outfit we're looking for today you can't find in the stores. The Bible says in Ephesians 6:11, wear the full armor of God. Wear God's armor so that you can fight against the devil's evil tricks. Every day we need the armor of God. Clea is going to put on the armor of God today as I talk about it. Wear the belt of truth around your waist. Jesus answered, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. The only way to the Father is through me. Over your heart goes the breastplate of righteousness. Be very careful about what you think. Your thoughts run your life. On your feet, wear the gospel of peace. So we have been sent to speak for Christ. It is as if God is calling to you through us. We speak for Christ when we beg of you to be at peace with God. For your enemy's arrows, use the shield of faith. Your kingdom will continue forever, and you will be king from now on. The Lord will keep his promise. With love, he takes care of all he has made. The helmet of salvation goes on your head, so when the battle gets hard, you can stand. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever so believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Use the sword of the Spirit. It is God's word. Use the sword of the Spirit and stand on his word. So give yourself to God. Stand against the devil, and the devil will run away from you. It is important to remember that you live in a world where your spiritual enemies never declare a truce. So you need to stay alert and ready for battle. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your guard. And after you have done everything to stand, let us pray. Father God, I put on and stand firm with the belt of truth buckled around my waist. I am safe and secure with the breastplate of righteousness guarding my heart from evil, helping me live a life that honors you. I diligently put on the gospel shoes of peace, willing to go wherever you ask me. I will take a stand behind the shield of faith, protected against Satan's fiery darts of doubt, fear, lies, and deceit. Now, on my head, I place the helmet of salvation, keeping my mind focused on you. I grab hold of my hands, the sword of the Spirit, the word of God, sharp and true. I am prepared to live today in spiritual victory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, thank you for being patient as we were created and following the Spirit or my mistakes in the song. But it's great to have you with us this morning. And thank you, Terry, for that great children's message. If you get bored and you got kids around, or maybe even if you don't have kids around, what a fun craft to do. That is one of the most creative things I've ever seen done with a serving tray. Would you agree, making it into a shield? I love, yeah, go ahead. I can't clap because I went, that's good. Thank you very much. And Clea, you're a great warrior, so, and a good sport too, I would say. So it's great to have you here again this morning. This morning we continue the series of Turning Point, and this morning we're looking at bouncing back after a breakdown. And we are in 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 through 19. It's a bit of a lengthy story, but I think it's a great story with some really great truths. Now, Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done, how he had killed all the prophets with a sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, "May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them." Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. He came to a broom bush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. "I've had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. Then he went into a cave and spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I've been zealous for Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with a sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." The Lord said, "Go out and stand up on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Then a great and powerful wind tore through the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face, went out, and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with a sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came, and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Japhat, from Abel-Meholah, to succeed you as prophet. Yet I reserve 7,000 Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal." So Elijah went from there and found Elisha, son of Japhat. He was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was not driving the 12th pair. Elijah went up to him and threw his cloak around him. May the Lord bless his word to our hearts and minds this morning. Well, as I said, this morning we're thinking about bouncing back after a breakdown. I don't know what kind of a week you're having this week, but many folks are struggling even amidst the pandemic. And have you ever had a dark week? Have you ever struggled with depression and maybe anxiety so severe it was almost crippling? I had a friend in college, and he was sort of a macho guy, but when he was having a bad week, sometimes he'd come in and he'd sit down and he said, "You know what, guys? I'm feeling so low, they'd have to jack me up to bury me." And then he would begin to share his week and all the things that he was going through. And so he had a sense of humor. He was a macho guy. And he made us laugh, but then he made us realize what he was going through. And a lot of us many times go through a dark chapter of our life. And so I think even though it's serious, it's important to address that topic this morning. And I think during the pandemic, there's a lot of folks who are sort of cloistered away, and they're going through difficulties made all the worse because we can't be with people and even get a hug now and then from those we love. And so people have lost their job, and people have broken relationships, and some people have loved ones in the hospital, and some folks have even lost loved ones to the pandemic or something else. And I don't know if you've ever witnessed or been close to someone who has gone through a chapter so dark in their life that they've taken their own life. For my daughter and I suppose for her particularly, it's the first time it was really real, is when Robin Williams took his own life. And we love, to this day, Robin Williams. I love the movies, Aladdin and Night at the Museum. Maybe you do too. And the joy and laughter that he inspired in so many people. Even he's overcome many struggles in his life, but then he had that moment that was must have been too dark for him and took his own life. And my daughter and I, you know, shared that moment and talked about there's never a moment dark enough. Just reach out. As a police chaplain, I've been called to homes where that tragedy has struck in that home and know the crippling hurt and grief, overwhelming grief that people go through having lost a loved one. And so even though it isn't the happiest, bounciest topic in the world, I think it's important that now and then that we talk about that in church, because we do go through darkness and depression. And St. John of the Cross called it the dark night of the soul. And so this morning, if you're not going through a moment like that, maybe you have a loved one who is or who will at some point. And I think this chapter in the Bible has some amazing truths for us to discover, even if it's a small chapter, and certainly if it's a great chapter of darkness in our life. And so we look at this story of Elijah, who at one point wants to give up and ask God to take his life. Now, that may not be news in and of itself, except for one thing. Elijah had one of the most storied pasts in all of the Hebrew Scriptures. In all the Bible, one of the greatest prophets. You may not recall some of these chapters, but it was Elijah who looked something like John the Baptist, I guess. You know, he had this camel hair and this big belt. Maybe he rode a Harley. I don't know. But he was this blustering guy who had the courage, the fortitude to go up to Ahab in the middle of one of the biggest corrupt histories in Israel's history, both politically and elsewhere, and told Ahaz that if he didn't get the country to repent, there'd be a drought. And sure enough, there was a drought, very severe drought. And as the drought began to creep on, then Elijah went out in the desert and sort of camped out by this little stream, and God sent ravens to feed him and had that a moment of ministry like none other. And then there came a point in that famine where the Lord whispered to Elijah that there was a new adventure in his life, and so he went to the town of Zarephath and found a widow there. And God had asked Elijah to have her share bread with him, and so he found her, and she shared back with Elijah that she was out getting sticks right then to make a fire, and she was going to take the very last of her flour and the very last of her oil and make a little cake for her and her son, and that would be their last meal. And Elijah said, listen, if you have the faith to share that with me and put God first, then I guarantee you that the flour will never run out and the oil will never run out throughout the entire famine. And she did, and God came through in that fulfillment. And there was even a moment when her son passed away, and she came to Elijah, and Elijah prayed over the son, and the son came back to life in this miraculous moment. Then there was a moment where Elijah faces down the prophets of Baal, and to show their false prophets, he has them do the sacrifices. He calls this big audience. This is a big kind of a sporting event almost. And Elijah says, listen, you call on your gods and see if your gods will have the fire rain down from heaven and burn up this sacrifice on the altar. And then when you're done, I'll have the one true God do that. And so these prophets of Baal get around this big altar, this big ceremony, all this big crowd there, and they begin to pray that their gods would destroy this, burn up this sacrifice on the altar. And Elijah, in all his boldness, begins to make fun of them because nothing happens. He says, maybe your God is out to a lunch break, or maybe your God is taking a bathroom break. He said it. You can check it out. Previous chapter, chapter 18. So he's making fun of him, and finally comes his moment, and Elijah says, listen, it's not enough that the sacrifice is there. I want you to dump buckets and buckets of water on it until it's saturated and soaked. And when they're done, Elijah says a prayer, and God sends fire from heaven, burns up all the sacrifice on the altar, and then God strikes those prophets. Now, then the voice of the Lord comes to Elijah and says, the famine is going to end. And I want you to pray. And so Elijah goes out on the mountain and he prays and he has a servant with him. And he says, listen, I'm praying. You go and check the other side of the mountain and to see if there's any rain clouds coming. And so he sends them out the first time, and the servant comes back and says, no, there's no clouds. And then Elijah prays again, sends them out again. And he does that seven times. First six times, nothing happens each time. On the seventh time, the servant comes back and said, yes, there's a cloud the size of a fist is all. And Elijah says, get on your horse and ride, because God is going to send rains like the floods. And it happens just like that. And Elijah must have thought that surely through all of this, the people would come to repentance. And he's excited, and so he runs the message. But the news that greets him is that Queen Jezebel is saying that by this very time tomorrow that she will have his life taken, and she swears to it by her life. And in that moment, Elijah has a meltdown. He has a breakdown. He goes out into the desert. He sends his servants packing, which is like letting your staff go, and lays down next to this stream and asks God to take his life. He gives up. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? You know, one thing is to say sometimes we just think it's the weak who struggle with depression or darkness and a dark night of the soul, but here's one of the strongest people in the Bible, one of the strongest in all of Scripture, and he has a meltdown. And not only does he have a meltdown, but he has it after his biggest moment as a prophet in his storied career. I think one lesson is that sometimes after our greatest victories come our biggest breakdowns. Why is that? Well, one reason is because even the victories have a lot of emotional toil. And sometimes just like a great ship that has micro fissures that form in the hull and then will go down in a moderate-sized storm, that sometimes the stress of all that we've gone through begins to create these fissures, and then there's a moment like Elijah, and we just have a meltdown, a breakdown. And so it was with Elijah that he had his biggest breakdown after his greatest victory. And the other lesson is that we can all have a dark night of the soul, even if you have a great faith, all right? If you think that being a believer makes you immune from depression or anxiety and despair, then you're kidding yourself. You need to take off the blinders and realize that those around you may be going through a dark night of the soul, and we ourselves might be despite our faith, which does help us get through it, even as it did Elijah. And so Elijah has this moment where he loses hope. He thinks he's all alone. He thinks he's the only prophet in the land, and he thinks that God doesn't have a future for him. And those are kind of the key elements of depression and even despair, and can lead to worse. And Elijah prays that God would take his life, and so he has this dark night of the soul. But here's what I think. There's a new dawn that breaks for Elijah, and I think there's some great lessons for us, additional lessons other than we can go through a dark night of the soul too, which is that God can come in a new dawn, but not always in the way that we think it will happen. So Elijah's woken up by an angel, and the angel doesn't have a message, doesn't have a pep talk. The angel says, there's some bread, and here's some water. And I think that's beautiful. So the first thing that God does is God cooks, okay? And you and I know the smell of fresh baked bread and what that can do sometimes over coals of fire. And God knew that Elijah was physically worn out as well as mentally and spiritually. And so God does what's needed most. God does the daily bread thing in a special way. And you and I know that sometimes what you need is not a pep talk, maybe not even a sermon. Thank you. I knew that was coming because Norm's here. What we need is a good bed and breakfast. Can you say amen? And all the women said amen too, all right? Sometimes what you need is the ministry of cinnamon rolls. I have a friend of mine, Sally Miller, who began her ministry in grief by making cinnamon rolls for someone in the hospital who had a complete meltdown. And took him homemade cinnamon rolls and coffee, fresh brewed, and just picked him up. Didn't answer all the great questions of the universe that we struggle with. Why is this happening to me? All the rest of it, but it did do something amazing. Lifted them physically and even spiritually by food. And so God does what's necessary. God cooks. God sends an angel. An angel is a messenger. You can be an angel too. You might not have all the answers about depression, anxiety, and despair, and hopelessness, but you can let that person know that they're not alone. You can make cinnamon rolls. You can make homemade bread and take it to someone and say, I care. And that's exactly what God did. And then he goes back to sleep because he needs sleep, right? And the angel wakes him up again. And the angel has another meal and says, listen, you need to eat. You need to get your strength up and you need to go on a journey. And so Elijah eats again. And we're told that he goes on a 40-day journey. Now, it's significant because 40 is a number many times of a spiritual journey in the Bible. You recall that Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 years. Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days. Moses was in the wilderness for 40 years. Other times we see 40 in the Bible, but he goes on this spiritual retreat. And where does he go? He goes to Mount Horeb. But you might know Mount Horeb as Mount Sinai because they're the same mountain. He goes to the holy mountain of Moses. And when he gets there, God has a message. First, he gets in the cave. And I want to ask you this morning, where are you with your cave this morning? I mean, some of us are cowering in the cave, are we not? And for good reason. Okay, there's a pandemic going on. Some folks without a job, some folks with loved ones who are sick or have lost loved ones. But we all have a cave moment in life. But Moses does it there in a retreat, waiting for God. And God shows up. So God cooks and then God whispers. Or rather, God listens first, I should say, because God says to Elijah, why are you here? Why are you here? Now, do you think God didn't know why Elijah was there? Of course God knew why Elijah was there. But sometimes we don't need a person to tell us what we need to hear. We need to be able to listen. And so God was a really good counselor and asked Elijah why he was there. Elijah said, well, I'm alone, and I'm the only faithful one in the country, and I've done everything I can. They're killing the prophets, and now I just want to give up and die. And then the interesting thing is God asked the question again later. Because you know what? Every good counselor asks the question at least twice. From a psychologist. Why? Because we always need to tell more. Because we never really answer it with all of our emotions the first time. So even though he gave the same or similar answer the second time, I bet there was even deeper emotions. And so God not only cooks, God listens. And sometimes you and I, we don't need to give someone a sermon or a set of platitudes or anything or a pep talk. We need to just listen. Right? We don't want someone to fix it. We want someone to listen. And so God cooks and God listens and then God whispers, right? God tells Elijah he's about to pass by. And so Elijah is still afraid to come out of this cave and a mighty wind comes and the wind shakes the mountains. But it says God wasn't in the wind. And it says there was an earthquake that shook the mountain and it says God wasn't in the earthquake. And then there was a fire that passed by that burned up everything around. It says God wasn't in the fire. But then there was a whisper of the voice of God. And Elijah, we're told, pulled up his cloak over his face and walked out. Like all of you, he put a face mask on, so that's good. Okay, just saying. Anyway, he goes out and he hears God whisper. And I think many times in our own life, we hear the noise of our noisy world and media and clamor and text messages and all the busyness of the world. We realize that God is not in that. And what we need to do is listen to the still, small voice of God. And so God whispers, and what does God whisper to Elijah? God whispers a voice and a message of hope and reconciliation. And that God is there with Elijah and that God cares and has a future for Elijah. And I think that's a beautiful moment. And the first thing is that God tells him he's not alone, that God cares about Elijah. And then God later on tells him, that, listen, there's 7,000 other prophets. They're all hiding in caves too, but you know, at least you know you're not depressed and in a dark moment yourself. But then God gives Elijah a future. He says, listen, I want you to go anoint this king. Go back the way you came from. You missed some ministry moments in everyday life. And then anoint this other king, and then anoint this new prophet that will be your successor. And it's interesting because those are just little moments. And, you know, when we have a breakdown, we can't do something big. But sometimes those little moments of restoration can do wonders. You need those small wins to come back. And so God knows that. God has him anoint these kings. Now, it's interesting because we have no record in Scripture that either of those kings were really believers in God. So you never really know what God is doing among people that you think are completely lost. So God's plan is afoot in ways you never realized, and maybe that dawned on Elijah. And then God tells Elijah that he needs to go anoint Elisha as his successor. And you know, there comes a point in life where we may have done a lot of great things in life, but we realize that there's a future and it isn't all about us. And we need to mentor the next generation, right? Our legacy is not just about us. Our legacy is about those who live on beyond ourselves. And so that's a whole new moment. And if in your right stage of life, that can make all the difference. Because we all have a limited amount of time here. And so God tells Elijah that it's Elisha who will be his successor. And that he has a new need in life, which is to mentor young Elisha. And so he goes on his way. And so I think that's beautiful, isn't it? That God whispers to Elijah that he's not alone in this still small voice, and that God gives him a new plan for his future, and that there's these ministry moments along the way. And Elijah does exactly that. He goes and anoints these kings that were on the way, and sometimes we miss the ministry moments when we're having a breakdown. That's understandable. Sometimes we miss that God is at work in places we never would have realized, and so sometimes we need a breakdown, but our bounce back involves that. And Elijah goes and finds Elisha, who is in this middle of this field. We don't know if he's planting or harvesting, but he's driving one of the team of oxen. And he goes up to him and he puts his cloak on him as a symbol that he's his successor. And tells him, you are going to be the next prophet and I'm going to mentor you. And Elisha says, it's a big surprise to him, wait a second, I got to go tell my parents. And Elijah says, there's no time. And Elisha not only leaves his plow, he burns it and follows Elijah to become the prophet you'll be reminded that is said to have had the double portion of the spirit of Elijah, if that's possible, right? Amazing that God has a future for all of us. Now listen, the reason I think that Elijah was called to mentor Elijah wasn't because he knew everything, was because he finally figured out that he didn't know everything. And I think that's true in our own lives, that the wise point becomes not that we know everything, but that we realize that we don't. We realize that we're not invincible, that we all have moments of darkness, we all have moments of struggle, even with depression or anxiety, whatever it is for you, and we have loved ones who do too. And so he mentored Elijah, and Elijah had a glorious future ahead of him, and Elisha too. I don't know where you are right now in the midst of this pandemic or just in regular life, but we're all going through some struggles. We're trying to do the best, even with a sense of humor, but we know that a lot of folks are struggling right now. We know that depression and anxiety are way up. Even suicide rates are way up, tragically enough. And so I say, don't ignore it. Be real about it. All of us struggle. All of us go through a dark night of the soul, even as believers. So reach out to each other. You could be the angel with the cinnamon rolls. You can be the angel with the hot coffee or tea or whatever it is, and you could be the one who listens as well. But wherever you are, know that God does care. God cares enough to listen, and God cares enough for a future. I want to close with a couple thoughts, which is people often say, well, how do I know what the voice of the Lord is? I mean, after all, Lily Tomlin, the great comedian, says, you know, when you talk to God, they call it prayer, but when you hear God talking to you, they call it schizophrenia. She was the one and only. I love her. Anyway, it's true, isn't it? How do we know the voice of the Lord? I don't know if you've seen the movie A Beautiful Mind, the true story of John Nash, this great MIT mathematician who struggled with schizophrenia, of all things, and heard these voices tell him to do all kinds of things. He was so brilliant, they tried to do everything he could for his math studies and teaching at MIT, and he ended up having a very successful career, but struggled with schizophrenia all of his life. If you've seen the movie, you know this, but in real life, towards the end of his career, and the movie ends with this, is that someone asked him, you know, you hear all these voices, how do you know what the right voice is? And he said, I've come to realize that all of us hear lots of voices in life, but we all have to know which ones are true, and I have some friends around me to let me know the true voices. And I would say to all of us that the true voice of God is a whisper, not necessarily the fire and the wind and the earthquake of the media and the storm and all the clamor, but the still small whisper that comes to us with a voice of restoration, of forgiveness, of love, that God cares about our brokenness and our struggle and even our darkest chapters in life. In John chapter 3, Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night. And many scholars wonder why Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night. Was it because he was worried about his peers? Was it because he was worried about the other religious leaders? Was he worried about the Romans? A lot of scholarly ink put on paper for that. But someone once said perceptively, maybe we shouldn't ask why Nicodemus came to Jesus at night, but maybe we should ask why Jesus was out at night. That's a good question, isn't it? I think I know the answer. I think that Jesus was out at night because he wanted to share Nicodemus's darkest moment with him. That Nicodemus was going through a dark night of the soul and was seeking Jesus, and Jesus was there to give him a message of love. And I think Jesus would want us to know that Jesus is still there in our dark night of the soul. And that message of love that Jesus whispered to Nicodemus, that has rung through the pages of history from John 3:16, is still just as true today as it was then. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. That God wants you to know that you're loved, that Jesus is here in our brokenness and our darkness to share that, not a message from the sky, but a message of love. A message in our darkest night, bringing a new dawn of hope. Close with this one thought, which is a story that I love. And the story is from back in the early part of the 20th century. And back in the time of telegraphs, when they used Morse code over the wire to send a message. And so this young man goes to apply for a job as a telegraph operator, and he goes into this waiting room. And there is a message on the door that's closed that says, when you're summoned, come into the office. And so he sits down, and there's five or six other people in that waiting area, and suddenly this young man gets up amidst this noise of the office in the background, and he goes in through the door, closes it, and about 10, 15 minutes later, the young man walks out with the manager, and the manager looks around at all the applicants that are waiting out there and says, listen, you can leave now. This man has gotten the job. And they're all aghast. And they said, how come we didn't get a chance to interview? How come you didn't call us into the office? And the manager said, well, I just want to share this with you, that in the midst of all the noise of this office here and this closed door, there was a message in Morse code being tapped out in the other room that said, if you hear this message, get up and walk through the door. And this young man did, and he got the job. And I think in our own lives, many times there's a lot of clamor out there in the world. We're all going through a lot of brokenness and struggle. But through the dim and clamor and all the wind and the fire and the earthquakes, there's that still small voice of God, if we just tune into it, that says, I love you. You're not alone. I have a plan and purpose for your life, and I care about you. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, even as we do often struggle with a dark night of the soul of depression or anxiety or brokenness or just hopelessness, Lord, or have loved ones who do, we know that this message is still as true today as it was back in the day of Elijah, that you come to us in our broken and despairing and dark moments, and you breathe a message of hope and love and grace and restoration. So, Lord, help us to be real about our struggles and to share it with those we love. But help us to realize that even in the darkness is the still small voice of God whispering your love to us. even as Jesus was there for Nicodemus on that night. We pray that we'll all hear your voice of love in Christ's name. And all God's people said, amen.
The song I'm going to play is "The Savior is Waiting." It was written by Ralph Carmichael. At age 17, Ralph was a violinist in the San Jose Symphony Orchestra, and he enrolled in Vanguard University. He wanted to become a preacher, just like his father, grandfather, several uncles, and three of his brothers. But deep inside, there was a musical calling. So he formed a musical quartet that would perform in different churches. He liked to mix classical with some contemporary things that he had written. This did not go over extremely well with the churches. In fact, one time the preacher stopped him midstream and said, "Too worldly, get out." He also was, at one church, they put the drums behind a curtain so they couldn't see them. So it took a while for Ralph to find his niche. In 1970, he was asked to write the score for the movie The Cross and a Switchblade. That kind of was his jumping point. From then on, he was sought after quite highly to write different music for different TV shows and other things. "The Savior is Waiting" is one song that was written by Ralph at the request of a friend who wanted a song to close the service, the invitation to accept Jesus. So every night at this camp, they would sing "The Savior is Waiting." So the words are up here. You can kind of follow along.
Beautiful, Stephen. Thank you. I love that song. As we go before the Lord in prayer, I want to lift up a couple needs. Norm Nellis's granddaughter, Michaela, needs a healing touch. Brenda O'Brien's father passed away earlier this week. And then my niece, Valerie, is struggling with COVID-19. She has for some time. She's been in and out of the hospital. And so please lift her up in prayer as well. I know there's lots of other needs in our midst as well as things to give thanks for. Let's take a few moments of silent prayer before we go before the Lord together. Lord, we're so thankful that amid the busyness of life, that we can take time out and come into your place of worship, whether here in the sanctuary or at home or even in our car. We can push the pause button and just lift up our needs to you and our burdens, and also pause to give you thanks for the blessings of the day. So today, before we bring you our needs, we want to thank you for the blessings of life, the blessings of the beauty and wonder and majesty of all creation around us. We're thankful for the bounty and blessings of our farms and fields and factories and places of business. We're thankful for country and community, and friends and family, and so many other things in life. So we thank you. But we're also so thankful for the grace and love of Jesus Christ come to share our lives and our hurt and our brokenness, and to bring us a message of love and grace and restoration. And then go to the cross that we might know your forgiveness and grace, and be raised to new life, that we would know the power of new life in this life and the promise of new life to come. Help us to open our hearts and lives to your amazing grace today. And then, Lord, help us to share the good news of your love with others near and far. Lord, we also lift up our needs. We lift up those who've lost loved ones and pray that your peace and love and strength would be with them. We lift up those who need a healing touch, whether at home or hospital or nursing home. Be with those who are caring for them, our doctors and nurses and medical folks. Give them continued courage and wisdom. Bless the medications that they're taking. But we also pray that you, our great physician, would touch and strengthen them in body, mind, and spirit with your healing presence. We lift up those who need healing in relationships and pray you'd heal relationships and bring peace and love. We pray, Lord, for those who need wisdom for decisions, those who are struggling with depression or anxiety or whatever it is, Lord. Be with them in a special way. Bring light into their darkness. We pray you bless all of our missions and ministries, whether here in our community or around our world. Help us to bring peace and goods and blessing to everyone in need, whatever their need might be. And we pray that all of us would be your church, the body of Christ, a city with a lamp lit on the hill, shedding light to those near and far through your power and to your glory. We pray all this in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Go forth the blessing of Almighty God, the love of the Father, the grace of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus, and the peace and power of the Holy Spirit now and forever. Amen. God bless you, and have a great week.